there is alternatives. Let's say there is so-called semi-structured databases or object-oriented databases or free text databases, you know, and many other things, right? But relational databases have established themselves as, in a sense, the industry standard.
This was Professor Christoph Kroc of the IC School at TPFL. And as you've guessed, we are going to discuss relational databases.
There was a big change in how we did database systems about, you know, around 1970. Before that, we didn't have the relational model. And we also kind of had only programming languages that were really much like Python or Java, where we just said, this is how you compute it. And they were all very low level, right? And you would go into, let's say, the details of how the data is actually stored on your hard drive or whatever, right? And after that, you have this abstraction of a clean mathematical model, a relational model, and languages that are declarative. And initially, people were saying in around 1970, you will never be able to make this efficient. It would be always super slow. And it would be super naive, and it's a bad idea to do it that way.
Do you see the trouble with that, though? Basically, you would need to be an expert to manage your database. And also, there would be a huge risk of errors when manipulating the database.
But then people, like computer scientists, went on this, and there was an intensive effort over many years. And they built things called query optimizers and smart query execution engines, which take this declarative description and analyze it and turn it into a very efficient program to execute it. And this is only possible because the language is declarative and simple. And restrictive.
In particular, because of how easy to use they are, relational databases are used throughout the industry to the point where these days they are at the heart of a $1 trillion industry, as we discussed in a previous video.
The relational model has become the most popular model, and that is not about to change anytime soon, I think. For a number of reasons. I mean, one is it seems to be particularly well suited for kind of commercial applications. It is also very simple to think about and reason about. It's in mathematics, there is an abstraction, an idea of a relation, which is a very simple to describe thing. And it corresponds very closely to what people call the relational data model, right? It also allows us to kind of model queries, let's say, query languages by mathematics. So one thing is logic. You know, logic as a query language is a way of kind of asking questions about what is in a database. It is very convenient to use the relation model here because it is very closely aligned with how people usually formalize logic anyway.
So relational databases are arguably some of the greatest ideas in computer science, but what are they?
Well, a relational database is a system that uses as its data model so-called relations.
Okay, what's a relation?
The idea is that, you know, records, you know, like the information about your social security number, your name and your address that you might want to register when you're a customer of a company or the government needs to know about you or whatever these kind of things might be, right? That would be one record, one line, one row in such a big table.
And crucially, these rows
establish a relationship between, let's say, your name and your social security number, or your social security number and your address.
More generally, a relation will be a set of such rows, and this makes up a full table.
And it could grow arbitrarily large. It's a finite set. You know, it's there because you add it there, and you can remove it again. Right. So that's, in principle, the idea of a relation.
Now, in such a row of a table, my name could be associated with my phone number. However, Le is a very, very common name in Vietnam. So if people actually used the names of the relational database to search for phone numbers, I would probably get a lot of very weird phone calls. No, I'm not a go-go dancer. You got the wrong link. To make sure that relational databases avoid these kinds of confusion, computer scientists had the great idea to introduce so-called primary keys.
Primary keys are something I can associate abstractly with a relation in a relational database system. So there's this notion of schema, which is basically the metadata that says this particular relational table, you know, has three columns. The first column has strings inside, the second column has integers inside, and the third column has telephone numbers inside that have a particular format, let's say, right? So that's a schema. And then I could additionally say, well, a column or a set of columns, a subset of the columns of a table are a primary key. And if I declare that, there's a declarative interface to the database system to actually declare it and say, this must be true, right? If I declare a set of columns or a single column as a primary key, it means that for there will be no two tuples, no two rows or records in the same table that are different but have the same values in these key columns. So we can say the primary key will identify the tuple.
And in particular, there would then be a way for our relational database to distinguish me from Google Dancer Lake.
And you can then use this to refer to it elsewhere in the database.
And that's very useful.
So for example, if I have a table student in a university database, right? And the student has a student ID, which identifies that student, right? And then it's the name of the student and which thing they study and things like that, right? There might be additionally another table which has grades in there. And it says for this student ID and that course, I have, that particular grade, right? And the student ID in there would be called a foreign key. It's a pointer to that key. And in fact, it would just take this student ID and mention it in this point. And then I can do what is called a join to combine these two tables, to map them so that the students are matched with their grades. So that's it would be a key and foreign key relationship.
In other words, we can now create and exploit relations between different tables. And in particular, this allows us to create interconnected data in a very informative and very concise way. For instance, the grade table will not have to list the names and phone numbers of all students. It will simply point to the right row of the student table, which will have all the relevant information.
So a relational database system is not a single relational table in general. It could have many, right? Some big applications, let's say like SAP, they might have more than 10,000 different tables.
This idea of using primary keys has strong resemblance with the idea of pointers in programming languages like Java or C.
The reason why I don't use pointers is this is more robust, right? I mean, the database system will survive a restart, right? So I will shut down the database system and I will restart it. And after that, the same tuples will be at a different place in memory. So address in a naive sense would not be desirable, right? And there's many other reasons why, using kind of classical, pointer addresses is not a robust solution here, right? This thing is something that I could also use to, I could copy the database between different machines that use very different architectures, maybe different amounts of memory have, so I cannot use address mapping.
This means that relational databases are flexible, robust, and efficient representations of the data, and this makes them very appealing to computer scientists. But as we said it early on, their crucial selling point is actually their user-friendliness. And this user-friendliness relies on so-called queries to access the data.
Any question, right, that could be answered purely out of that data in the database, you could argue is a query. Usually these query languages are not Turing complete. They are not restricted language compared to a language like Java or Python. There is things you cannot do in these languages. And this is not a fault, but it's a feature. It's intentionally so because the languages give syntax that makes it particularly easy to ask typical questions in them at the cost of not being able to answer other questions at all, right? And the other advantage of having a restricted language, apart from making it easier to use in many cases, is it often can be formally analyzed by software to do optimizations internally, right? So query languages tend to be what you call declarative, which means you say basically what you want to get rather than how to compute it.
And this makes queries much easier to use than Java or C.
If I write a program in Java, let's say, I will usually say these are the compute steps that your computer should execute that you get the result that I want, and you show me the result, right? But in query languages, you usually say, I would like to get this data, and you don't say how to compute it. So you don't say, fetch it this way, and then run this algorithm to analyze it, but you say, this is what I would like to see as a result.
Let's give an example.
Give me the students that have taken the database systems course at EPFL in the year of 2015, and who have achieved a grade of 6.0. And that is absolutely a query that I can write in a language, in a standardized query language called SQL, and it really uses basically simple English. So the question is very similar to what I just asked. And you type this, it's not, there's restricted syntax so that there is no ambiguity in parsing it. The computer will really know exactly what you mean. But it's still, there's keywords in English like select, from, where this condition holds, etc. That's actually really syntax in this language. And you say what you want to get as a result and how you want to display it, but you don't say how to compute it.
And this allows relational databases to be robust to bad users. And I'm including myself in this set of bad users. In fact, when we are dealing with $1 billion worth relational databases, even the greatest computer scientist has to be regarded as a potential bad user. However, even bad users will still be able to manage their relational databases efficiently with little chance of screwing them up too badly. And this is the key to the success of relational databases.
So business people tend to like this kind of tabular format, right? And it's very convenient for them.
However, we should not leave you with the impression that relational databases are the key to every database management problem. Depending on applications, more optimized databases may be preferable.
If you are an organization that manages maybe medieval texts that you have scanned from old manuscripts and so on, relational databases is maybe not the best thing. You could somehow put this kind of scanned data somewhere in there. That's certainly possible, right? But another maybe more flexible model is more suitable, right? If you have basically some software that generates complex objects with strange, you know, shapes, etc., also in terms of data, it's not flat tuples, but it has, you know, nesting inside in terms of the structure, right? You might prefer an object-oriented database. If what you want to do is hibernate the state of a program that is running, you want to kind of shut down and then restart and have the same state again, right? And you have done this by object-oriented programming, it might be more convenient for you to use a so-called object-oriented database system, right? But each of those things are interchangeable. There is a way of kind of converting objects into relations and vice versa, etc.
Relational database systems properly organize information into relational tables and are designed to handle such critical reliability issues, thereby relieving users from worrying about all of this.
If the database of that bank gets lost, you know, the money is gone.